Good to see you in the Lord's house this morning. It's a great day. It's just a great day to be in the Lord's house. I'm just glad I'm saved. I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad Jesus, God's still on the throne. Nothing taken by surprise. We're so glad to have you. Thank you for coming. If you're a visitor, you're our special guest this morning. You just mind the Lord and make yourself at home. But it's good to be here this morning. We want to just welcome. Good to have you. But anyway, we'll make a few announcements and get going this morning. It's good to have Brother Matthew Durham with us this morning. He'll be breaking bread of life. You uplift him. Pray for him. Brother David Durham, we had last week, this is his son. You uplift him, pray for him, and he'll deliver God's message, follow receptive ears, receptive hearts, and with mind the Lord's will. If you announce, we'll go farther. If you need a printout on your tithes and offering, just get there's a sign-up sheet here. If you need that, or just get with Jeff, and they'll get that for you. Remember, next Sunday is Youth Sunday, so ask a youth to, if you want a youth to help out in your class, be sure and ask them, and or we'll just appoint them. How's that? Hot. Reminder there that we still have a broadcast on local channel 183 every Saturday night at 8 p.m. and Sunday morning at 9. Also, a reminder here, as we had, if you remember, we had Harlan and Debbie Garner here a while back representing the summit. They're going to be having a fundraiser. They're going to be having a banquet Saturday, January 28th at 5 p.m. Nazareth Baptist Church Life Center in Ranchville. And the tickets for that will be $40. So if you can help out and support that cause, and I'd be greatly appreciated. Any other announcements before we move any further this morning? Again, it's good to see you this morning. Welcome. Good to have you in the Lord's house. Nothing else, we'll ask our ushers to come forward and we'll receive this morning's offering. Steve, I get you asking the Lord's blessings this morning.
for me what I could not do there under the blood. Just like the Passover in Egypt's land, it took the blood to save me. Washed and made clean, I'm justified when God sees the blood. Faith through the ages of three.
a city of lights where there cometh no night, and the sun never sets in the sky. In the Bible we're told that the streets are pure gold, and the cool gentle river runs by.
I'm bound for that city, God's holy white city. Oh yes I am, I'll never turn back to this world anymore. No matter how rough may be the way, no matter how oft I stop to pray, I'm bound for that city on that evergreen shore.
Little children will play and their hearts will be gay as they stroll down that city of light. There'll be no dying up there, no more burdens to bear, and nobody will grow feeble.
On us this morning. Thank you for the spirit we're feeling. And thank you for the songs. We ask you just to stand for a moment. Let's fellowship. Shake hands with our visitors. Make sure you shake hands with somebody and tell them you love them this morning.
Come ahead, Brother Matthew. As he comes in, one other announcement this morning, Miss Dorothy Hedrick called. Wanted us to pray for her grandson, Ian Hedrick. His leukemia has come back, so let's pray for this young man. God knows the need. He's still on the throne. Brother Matthew, go. It's all yours.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Yes, brother.
It's good to be with you this morning. I appreciate the opportunity to come. Especially 25-year-old, not many people put a lot of trust, a lot of faith in someone I never heard before. I appreciate the church. I appreciate the opportunity. I have to say I appreciate my dad for having the faith in me as well. I know he's enjoyed his time here. He's bragged the entire time since he's been here. He's grown close to y'all. I know he loves you. I know he's great for the opportunity as well. As you turn in this morning, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2. As we turn, if anyone has a word they'd like to share this morning. Ephesians chapter 2. I'll begin reading in verse 7. If you're willing and able, would you stand for the reading of God's word this morning? Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 7. That in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I come to you this morning, Lord, and I ask your blessings on your red word this morning, Father. I ask, God, that you anoint me, God, allow me to preach this morning with power, but God, most of all, Lord, hide me behind the shadow of the cross. Lord, let there be nothing seen of me this morning, Father, but let it all be seen of Jesus. Lord, and I pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Over the last few months, God has begun to reveal different things to me, begin to show me things that in my adolescence I had taken for granted. I'd looked over, and it may just be part of getting a little bit older. You begin to kind of change your mind towards high school and college, trying to find a girl to date and eventually marry to. Now we're progressing to we're wanting to build a home, start a family, do these kind of things. And I began to think, and I began to think back over what short time I've had on this earth, and I began to think that, boy, I've taken a lot of stuff for granted. I've taken a lot of stuff for granted in my life. I had a grandfather pass away about 5 years ago, and I look back and I think all those times that I just said, I'll go by one more time. I'll go by another day. I don't have time to stop today. What I'd do to give back, to be able to go back and sit and just talk a little while. And we've got a little niece that we see, and it seems just like yesterday I was holding her in my arms, bottle feeding her, and we had her last weekend, and she's running through my house destroying it. She's two now, and how quick time goes by. And how when everything's said and done, I look back and I think, boy, if I just had a little more time. Taking a lot of stuff for granted in my life. But sadly, I believe I can speak for me this morning, but I've taken things in my spiritual life for granted. I've taken things for granted to the point to where I look back, and I think we can see the evidence of this across the church, not Mount Carmel Baptist Church, but just the church as a whole. We look back and we see God's grace. We see that initial appointment time, that initial first time of experiencing God's grace. And then for so long in my life, I walked away and said, I've got it. I've got my fire insurance. I understand. God gave me His grace, gave me His mercy, He saved me. And I just kind of left it behind. And this morning, I want us to look and I want us to see and I want to drill down basically to the doctrine of salvation, to grace itself this morning. That's what I want us to look at. And I want to reignite that fire within you. I want to reignite that first burned with hot flame that maybe has gone down to an ember this morning. I want to get that to the point to where it blazes again. First, for us to understand this thing called grace, we must look at what grace is. We must first see what grace is. And someone described it this way. It's everything for nothing for those who don't deserve anything. It's everything for nothing for those who don't deserve anything. There was a minister was having a conversation with an atheist man at one point, and him and the atheist were talking, and the atheist said, how can you prove to me that God's real? How can you prove to me that there really is this deity that you call God, that you call Christ, that you call the Holy Spirit? How can you prove this? And the atheist looked up to the heavens and said, if there's a God, let Him strike me dead right now. Moment went by, nothing happened. The atheist looked at the minister and said, see, I told you, there's no such thing as God. And that minister said, you've just gave a providing example of God's grace. Grace is what sets Christianity apart. Grace is what makes us different. In the early 1940s in Great Britain, they were having a a conference on comparative religions. And they gathered all the great theological minds of that time, and of not just Christianity, but of Buddhism and Hinduism and atheism and agnosticism and Islam and all these different religions. The greatest minds they had gathered in one room. And they began to talk, and they began to try to figure out what sets Christianity apart. Is it incarnation? And they went to the Old Testament and saw where Christ would incarnate himself as the angel of the Lord and said, that can't be it. Was it resurrection? Another religion spoke up and said, no, we have resurrection in our religion. And they began to get louder and louder and almost in an argument, screaming at one another across the conference room. And in walked an older gentleman. He opened the door and he said, what is all the fuss about? What is all this commotion about? And they said, well, we were trying to decide what sets Christianity apart. This old gentleman just grinned and said, that's easy. That's grace. That's grace. That gentleman was C.S. Lewis, probably one of the greatest theological minds we have of the 20th century. And he just simply says, it's grace. It's not the fact of with Hinduism and Buddhism and the Jewish covenant and the Muslim code of law and the eightfold path and all these different religions. They have ways of achieving the same thing that we call grace, that we call salvation. The only difference is the fact that when we establish grace, it's God reaching down in the mud and pulling us out and setting us up on an equal platform with His Son, to whereas these other religions say, well, you need to earn it. You need to do these things. You need to keep this particular set of rules. You need to keep this. It's not given. It's earned. It's God's love coming to us free of charge. And it goes against everything that this flesh wants. You know, if we put a sign out here this morning that said, ticket to heaven, $5. You'd make a buku of money and you'd fill this house in no time. Boy, that's easy. If I could just pay something, if I didn't have to trust anything, if I didn't have to put faith in anything, if I could just earn my way to heaven, it'd be a lot easier. There's a lot of people that want to teach you that this morning. There's a lot of people that want to, Oprah Winfrey wants to tell you there's multiple ways to heaven, that you can just earn it, that you can just jump through a certain set of hoops and you'll eventually be in the promised land. Other religions offer a way to earn approval for a righteous God. Christianity. We understand that grace is God's love coming to us free of charge. C.H. Spurgeon said, grace is the fountainhead of salvation. Everything that comes about from salvation comes through grace. That's what we see in Ephesians. That's what we understand in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. For by grace are you saved through faith. You know, for such a long time, I had allowed my mind to get wrapped up in the fact that I played a role in my own salvation. That it was because I put my faith in Him that I achieved salvation. Folks, it don't matter. I couldn't put my faith in Him 1,000 times if He didn't bestow His grace upon me at the very beginning enough to say that I love you, I'll reach down, I'll grab you, I'll pull you up, and I'll set you to be an equal heir with my Son. If you read Ephesians 2, verse 8, in the original Greek text, it makes this a little bit clearer. The word they use for faith has a feminine aspect to it, has a feminine gender to it, basically. The word that, and that not of yourselves, has a neutral gender. It doesn't have one. So, therefore, what Paul's saying is, it's not that the faith wasn't of ourselves. It's the fact that all of salvation was not us. It can't even be related. Faith and any kind of work-based salvation can't go together. That it is strictly by God's grace through faith, not of ourselves. There's no way to tie that together. We can't walk around and say that I played a part in my own salvation, that I was able to take God's grace and apply it to myself. It's not a supermarket. We can't walk down the aisle and pick from what we want. We can't go say, well, I'll take this, and I'll take this, and go to the checkout counter, pay for it, and go on into heaven. It doesn't work that way. It's God's grace reaching down, grabbing a hold of us. James 2:10 says, whoever keeps the whole law and offends in one point is guilty of all. The law was first given to show us the need of something. The law was given to show us that we're not perfect. That we can't, obviously, we can't reach up to a holy and perfect and righteous God in our sinful state. So the law was given to show us that we're in need of something. That we're in need of grace this morning. There's a reason Paul wrote verse 9. When he said it's not of works. Folks, this morning, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, praise God, but you did not have a part to play in that. We didn't. Matthew didn't have anything to do 15 years ago at a little church on Sylvania Gap that said, I'm gonna take care of this myself. It was the bestowment of God's grace upon my life. That he saw me in a sinful state. He saw you in a sinful state, and he said, but I love you. I love you. I love you. For us to appreciate grace, for us to truly appreciate grace, we have to see the alternative. We have to see how God deals with people. And God deals with people in two ways. He deals with them with grace. He deals with them according to the law. The law was given to show us that we're in need of something. We're in need of God's grace. We're in need of a Savior. We're in need of some sort of sacrifice applied to our lives. The blood that we walk through to get to God's throne. The fact that when I bow my head in prayer, I'm in His presence. And He has every right to strike me down. But Christ is sitting at His right hand saying, no, He belongs to me. My blood's been applied. Muhammad Ali was interviewed by Reader's Digest, I believe is who it was, in the 1980s. And they talked to him about his faith, why he changed his name, why he did all these things he did, why he converted to Islam. And Muhammad Ali stated that there was multiple ways to heaven, and he just chose that one. I call that the human effort versus salvation this morning. Romans 5:17 says, for if by one man's offense death reigned, one man's offense death reigned, much more they which received abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. Romans 5:20, the law entered that sin might abound. Law was given so that we would be able to acknowledge and see our sin and see how greatly it abounds in our life, but grace much more abounded. Where sin abounded, grace much more abounded. You know, we hear those quotes from celebrities, Muhammad Ali, Oprah Winfrey, pretty much anybody in Hollywood, basically. And we think to ourselves how foreign that sounds, how immoral that is, that someone could think that other than God's grace, other than salvation, that you could ever get to heaven, that you could ever achieve righteousness, that you could ever work for it. And we think that it's just those crazy folks out in L.A. that have got their minds twisted, that have joined Scientology and they've made up their own religion and they're trying to do these things. But sadly, the truth is, our world right outside these doors is living that way. The world outside thinks that I don't need to go to church. I can be a good enough person. I can keep a Bible on my bookshelf. I can take it out and read every once in a while. I can post those things drive me nuts on Facebook. Share if you love Jesus. I love Jesus. Jesus knows I love Him. Amen. My friends need to hear it come out of my mouth, Amen. Not on my Facebook wall. Amen. All right? But the world we live in thinks that if I just do enough, surely he'll let me in. If I just work hard enough, surely he'll let me in. In the movie Saving Private Ryan, we see a ranger, Army Ranger Corps go out to find this young man. You've probably seen the movie. At the end, Tom Hanks is leaned up against a tank or something, and he's dying. He's been shot. And he grabs that young man, he pulls him close to him, and he whispers in his ear. He says, "Earn this." Now, that's a great climactic point of the movie. Earn this. Make my life mean something to you. Earn for the rest of your life what I've done for you, what I've sacrificed. But doing a little bit of research, you can find out that a lot of Army Ranger Corps that went and saw that movie were heartbroken over what Steven Spielberg had done during that movie, because the Ranger Corps doesn't have that saying. That's not their motto. It's not "earn this," it's "I chose this." Jesus Christ is laying on that cross this morning, and he's not telling us to earn it. He's saying, "I chose it. I chose this for you." It's a free will. It's a free gift. It's God's grace being bestowed. And he says, "I chose this." We understand that grace is bestowed upon us. We can't achieve it on our own. We can't do anything to earn God's grace. We understand that, as Paul lays out, it's not anything of us, that it's not of me, that it's not of Matthew this morning, that it's not of Mount Carmel Baptist Church. Because if it was, if I could get you saved this morning, I'd already done it. If I could get you in right standing with God, I'd have already done it. But for those of us that have experienced God's grace for the first time, that know Jesus Christ as Savior, that understand what he did for us, that accept him as who he was, the perfect Lamb of God, that he lived a perfect life, that he came and he laid that life down on a cross for all of mankind. And we've accepted that, we understand that, we've put our faith in him, we've said, "Lord, I accept your grace, I thank you for it, I praise you for it, but now time has gone by. Things might have grown a little bit colder." We must rejoice in grace. We must always continue to rejoice in grace. In my personal life, that's where I failed. That's where I fell short. That's where I fell flat on my face before God, and I said, "Lord, I'm sorry, because I've forgotten your grace. I've forgotten what it means to have peace, to have joy in my life because of the things that you've done, because of the grace you gave me that Wednesday night of that revival service, that flame that you ignited in my heart with the Holy Spirit. I've forgotten that." Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2 says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God." Verse 9 says, "Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." Just those few verses tell us that you're given peace, you're given joy, you're given comfort, you're given security, you're given hope, you're given access to God the Father because of grace. All because of grace. My wife and I attend Henniger Baptist Church. That's where I've gone for the last 10, 13 years or so. And it was just a regular Sunday for me one day, a couple months ago. A regular service. Sang regular hymns. Sang regular specials. We sang what you could call the anthem to the Christian religion, "Amazing Grace." Can't tell you how many times I've heard it. Can't tell you how many times I've sung it. But God allowed me to hear something different that morning.
Amen.
Amazing grace. That first line in that song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. And I thought to myself, what does grace sound like? What does grace sound like this morning? I think it's different for everybody. My wife probably does not hear what I hear when I think, what does grace sound like? This morning I want to leave you with this thought. As they come to do an invitation hymn, I want to leave you with a thought. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. What does grace sound like to you? To Matthew? Sounds like a hammer striking a nail. For this old boy that didn't deserve anything. For this old boy that didn't deserve the breath of life that he was given in the first point, he definitely didn't deserve the Son of God coming and dying for him. He didn't deserve the fact that God said, I love him anyway, and I'll reach down and I'll offer it to him. He didn't deserve to take me as I was, but he did anyway. I don't deserve to be called by God to do what I'm doing this morning. I don't deserve anything he's given me in life. But God said, I'll give you my grace. This morning, if you've grown cold and indifferent, and you need to get back under the stream of God's grace and just let it pour over you. If you're here this morning and you've realized, I've never experienced God's grace, but I can feel Him. I can feel Him tugging. I can feel Him whispering. I can feel Him knocking. Whatever your need may be, I don't know your hearts this morning, but these altars are open. So we stand and sing what number? Can you hear it?